find solids. We have seen the characteristics of solids and also classified the solids into crystalline and amorphous types. Now let us study the meaning of the two terms, that is isomorphism. See here, iso means same, and morph means form or structure. Similarity or dissimilarity in the crystal structure have been identified on the basis of these two terms, isomorphism and polymorphism. Now let us see the meaning of isomorphism. Two or more substances having similar properties that are called as isomorphous with each other, and they are said to be isomorphous in nature, and this phenomenon is called as isomorphism. Let us see once again the definition of isomorphism. Two or more substances having same crystal structures are said to be isomorphous, and this phenomenon is called as isomorphism. Isomorphous substances are showing same crystal structures. Let's see the examples of isomorphous substances so that you can get the clear idea about them. The first example, sodium chloride and magnesium oxide. Second example, that is sodium nitrate and calcium carbonate. And the third one, the third example, that is potassium sulfate and potassium selenate. Now these two substances, sodium chloride and magnesium oxide, they are isomorphous in nature, that is they are showing same crystal structure. Similarly, the pairs sodium nitrate and calcium carbonate, they also show isomorphism. Similarly, the third example, potassium sulfate and potassium selenate, they are isomorphous in nature. Now, if you observe the chemical composition of these substances, there is a same atomic ratio. Let us see sodium chloride. We know that sodium chloride consists of one sodium atom and one fluorine. So its atomic ratio is 1:1. While magnesium oxide, it also contains one magnesium atom and one oxygen atom. So again, the atomic ratio of magnesium oxide is 1:1. Similarly, in sodium nitrate, you will observe one sodium atom, one nitrogen atom and three oxygen atoms. And also in calcium carbonate, one calcium atom, one carbon atom and three oxygen atoms. Here again you will observe both of these compounds are showing same atomic ratio. Similarly, the atomic ratio in potassium sulfate is 2:1:4. In potassium selenate, you will again observe the same atomic ratio. So from these examples, we can conclude that the polymorphous substances are showing the same atomic ratio. But see, one exception is there. All the compounds which are showing similar atomic ratio are always not said to be isomorphous in nature. Here, let us see sodium chloride and potassium chloride. Now, you will observe that both are having same atomic ratio, that is 1:1. But if you observe their crystal structures, they are different. Later on, we will study the structure of sodium chloride and potassium chloride. Just now, remember that both are having different structures, though their atomic ratio is same. But in general, we can say that isomorphous substances are showing the similar atomic ratio. Now, in polymorphous substances, we have seen that in polymorphous substances, let us see, a single substance exists in two or more different forms or different structures. So, let's see the definition of polymorphism. A single substance that exists in two or different forms or structures is said to be polymorphous, and that phenomenon is called as polymorphism. So, in polymorphism, we will observe two or more forms. Let us see the example of polymorphous substances. Calcium carbonate, that is CaCO3, has two polymorphs. First one, that is calcite, and the second one, that is arachnoid. See second example, silica, that is SiO2. It has three polymorphic forms. First one, alpha quartz. Second one, beta quartz. And the third one, that is crystalline. Now, some elements are also showing this polymorphism. Now, polymorphism occurring in elements is also called as allotropy. A special word allotropy is used for the polymorphism occurring in elements. Let's see the examples of polymorphism or allotropy in carbon. We know very well carbon exists in three allotropes, that is diamond, graphite and fullerene. Similarly, sulfur has two allotropic forms, monoclinic sulfur and rhombic sulfur. Have you understood the term isomorphism and polymorphism? Now, let's study the details about crystalline structure. Students, in this year, you have to study in detail only the crystalline types of solids. So, let us see the classification of crystalline solids. Depending upon the types of particles present in crystalline solids, they are classified mainly into four types. First one, ionic crystals. Second one, that is covalent network crystals. that is the ion metallic resonance. We can say these four types as ionic solids, covalent solids or covalent network solids, molecular solids and metallic solids also. Now let us see the constituent particles present in all these four types. Obviously, in ionic crystals, you will observe the charged ions present between them. You know very well, the ions are of two types, cations and anions. So, the constituent particles in ionic crystals are charged ions. In covalent network crystals, the constituent particles are non-metal atoms. Atoms of non-metals like carbon, phosphorus are present in covalent crystals. Now, in molecular crystals, you will observe the molecules as the constituent particles. While the metallic crystals contain the metal atoms as the constituent particles. So, on the basis of constituent particles present in these solids, we can define all these four types. Let us see the definition of ionic crystals. The crystals in which the constituent particles are charged ions, that is cations and anions, are called as ionic crystals or ionic solids. Similarly, the solids in which the constituent particles are the atoms of non-metals, that are called as covalent network crystals or simply covalent solids. The solids in which the constituent particles are molecules, that are called as molecular crystals, while the solids in which the constituent particles are metal atoms are called as metallic crystals. Now let us see the force of attraction between these four types of crystals. Here, since cations and anions are present and they are oppositely charged, we know very well that we have studied in physics that whenever two oppositely charged bodies come together, the special kind of force of attraction is existing between them, that is a strong electrostatic force of attraction. And in chemistry, we name this strong electrostatic force of attraction as the ionic bond. Now let us see the force of attraction in covalent network crystals. Here, the non-metal atoms are present in these crystals. And you know very well that in the non-metal atoms, only a covalent bond is present. So, the force of attraction between the covalent crystals is a covalent bond. Now, in molecular crystals, the force of attractions are of different kind. In 11th standard, in the chapter States of Matter, you have studied the different intermolecular forces of attraction. Now, in molecular crystals, dipole-dipole interaction is present. The second type of interaction between them, that is the dispersion forces, or they are also named as London forces, and also these molecules are showing hydrogen bonding. You have studied studied the details about all these types of interactions in 11th standard. Now, in metallic crystals, the metallic bond is present. The force of attraction is the metallic bond. So, what is metallic bond? So, you know, here metallic bond is nothing but the bond between positively charged cations and a sea of mobile electrons. We know very well that in metals, the metal ions are present which are carrying a positive charge, just like this. Since metals are highly electropositive, they can easily lose their electrons and the metal cations are formed like this. Now, where these electrons go? Now, these electrons are forming a sea in the metallic crystal, just like this. Thus, you will observe that in the metallic crystal, the metal ions are embedded in a sea of electrons. So, metallic bond is nothing but the bond where metal ions are embedded in a sea of mobile electrons. Now, let us see the third point regarding all these four kinds of crystalline solids, that is their melting point or boiling point. Now here you have observed the strong electrostatic forces of attraction between cations and anions, and therefore ionic crystals are showing high melting point and boiling point. Their melting point or boiling points are high. Now in covalent network crystals, the non-metal atoms are forming a three-dimensional network of the atoms and they are forming a giant molecule. For example, diamond. You know very well that in diamond all the sp3-hybridized carbon atoms are bonded with each other forming a long chain and they are forming a giant molecule. Since such networks of non-metal atoms are formed in the crystalline solids, in the covalent network solids or crystals, here they will show very high melting points. Diamond is showing very high melting point, you know very well. The molecular crystals are showing low melting point. Why? Because in 11th standard you have seen that all these types of interactions are weak as compared to interaction or covalent bond or ionic bond. Since the forces of attraction are weak, they will show low melting points or boiling points. Again, metallic crystals are showing a strong metallic bond and therefore they will also show a high melting point. Now let us see about the hardness of these four types. The ionic crystals are hard and brittle due to strong forces of attraction. The covalent network crystals are very hard. Molecular crystals are weak due to weak intermolecular forces. The metallic crystals are again either soft or hard. You know very well sodium. Sodium is soft, but calcium metal, that is a hard metal. So metallic crystals may be either soft or hard. Now let us discuss about the conductivity of these solids. In ionic crystals, since oppositely charged ions are present, you may say that they should be good conductors of heat and electricity. But remember well, the ionic crystals are non-conductors in solid state. When they are existing in solid state, they are non-conductors of heat and electricity. Let's see the example of sodium chloride. You know very well that when sodium chloride is present in solid state, it will not possess the free Na plus and Cl minus ions, and that's why it cannot conduct the electricity. But when that sodium chloride is melted or when it is dissolved in water, what happens? You will get free Na plus and Cl minus ions. And due to presence of such free oppositely charged ions, ionic crystals are good conductors of heat and electricity. So we can say that ionic crystals are good conductors of heat and electricity in molten state or in their aqueous solution, that is when they are dissolved in water. Now let us see the conductivity of covalent network crystals. Here the covalent network crystals are again non-conductors because all the non-metal atoms are binded with a covalent bond. There is absence of free electrons and therefore they are non-conductors. The molecular crystals, they are also poor conductors. Molecules are again binded with such force of attraction and therefore they are poor conductors. But metallic crystals are very good conductors of heat and electricity, because here you will observe a sea of mobile electrons. Due to presence of such mobile electrons, the metallic crystals are very good conductors of heat and electricity. Now let's see the examples of these ionic crystals so that you will easily understand all these characteristics. You know very well, all salts are the examples of ionic crystals. For example, sodium chloride, potassium chloride, copper sulfate, etc. Covalent network crystals, the examples are diamond, graphite, silica, etc. The molecular crystals are showing different kinds of examples depending upon the presence of these three kinds of interactions. If the molecular crystals are showing dipole-dipole interaction, then you can give their examples as hydrogen chloride, hydrogen fluoride, etc. Now, in such molecules, you will observe the production of two poles, that is dipole, and therefore when such molecules come close to each other, they get bonded with such weak force of attraction, that is dipole-dipole interaction. All these are the examples of polar molecules. Some molecules like non-metals, for example, hydrogen molecule, chlorine molecule, or sulfur molecule, or even carbon dioxide. All these are the examples of non-polar molecules, and you know very well these non-polar molecules are showing dispersion forces. See the examples of the molecules showing hydrogen bond. What is hydrogen bond? You know very well, when hydrogen atom is bonded with most electronegative atoms like fluorine or oxygen or nitrogen, then that molecules are said to possess a hydrogen bond. So then examples of the molecules showing hydrogen bonding, you know that examples, that is water, ammonia, etc. Here hydrogen is bonded with such most electronegative atoms, and therefore all these are the examples of molecular crystals. And what we have classified the crystalline solids into these four classes. We have studied the characteristic of all these four kinds of crystals. Now, how the question is asked in exam, let us see. The question may be asked for 2 marks, that is, explain ionic crystals or write a short note on ionic crystals. To achieve 2 marks, again you have to give at least 4 points in it. Or sometimes the question may be asked, that is, differentiate between ionic crystals and covalent paper crystals, or differentiate between ionic crystals and molecular crystals, or differentiate between covalent network crystals and metallic crystals. That is, you have to differentiate between any of these four types of crystals. Continue.